The biggest thing that the enemy wants to do to you today is to control what's right between your ears and your mind. And he wants you to come in this place this morning, this building, and he wants you to forget about what's going on. He wants you to remember everything that's going on in front of you. He wants you to think about what you brung in those back doors. He wants you to think about what the doctor said. He wants you to think about what somebody called you. You ever just had all of a sudden where the enemy begins to remind you of your past? He begins to remind you of what you've went through. He begins to remind you of all these things. Listen, there's a reason those things are still in your head. The Bible says that you're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. So you take what the devil has and he puts it in between your head and he's reminding you of something. You say, you know what? You're right. I did go through that. I did go through that. But you know what? I went through it. You testify to the thing. You say, I went through it. You know why? I went through it because of the blood of the Lamb. Because of Jesus died for me. Because he gave his life for me, I now can operate in heavenly things. Just say that name of Jesus this morning. The name of Jesus cancels out all debts. The name of Jesus heals all diseases. The name of Jesus cleanses everything. There's nothing that his blood can't do this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. There's nothing that he can't do this morning. The Bible said at one time, it says that in the seven sons of Sceva, he says this. He says that we're going to say the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches. And it says that the devil overtook them. The reason why the devil overtook them, because they weren't in the name of Jesus. But there's something about a child of God that is completely different than somebody that's false. You are in the name of Jesus. So when you speak the name of Jesus, heaven moves for you. The devil backs up and things are restored. Life is redeemed. What the devil took out of your bank account and made negative, he makes it positive. It's pressed down. It's run together. It's saying, listen, the devil wants you to be destroyed. The devil wants you to have nothing. But God says, I come that may have life and life more abundantly. So just worship him this morning. Give him a praise. Father, we welcome you in the name
magnify
of Jesus.
Jesus. Magnify the Lord. Magnify Jesus. Magnify the Lord. Magnify Jesus. Oh. Magnify the Lord. Magnify Jesus, magnify the Lord,
for he is worthy,
for he is worthy, for he is worthy, for he is worthy to be praised.
Magnify Jesus.
Magnify the Lord.
Magnify.
Magnify Jesus.
Oh.
Magnify the Lord. Magnify Jesus. Magnify the Lord.
For he is worthy.
For he is worthy.
Yes, he is.
For he is worthy. For he is worthy.
Yes, he is.
To be praised. To be praised.
Magnify
Jesus. Magnify the Lord.
Lift your voice and magnify.
Magnify Jesus. Magnify the Lord.
Yes, magnify.
Magnify Jesus. Magnify the Lord. Magnify Jesus. Magnify the Lord.
For he is worthy.
For he is worthy.
Yes, he is.
For he is worthy. For he is worthy. To be praised, to be praised,
one more time, magnify,
magnify the Lord.
Magnify
Jesus.
Jesus.
Magnify the Lord. Magnify
Jesus.
Magnify the Lord.
He is worthy.
For he is worthy.
Yes, he is.
For he is worthy. For he is worthy to be praised.
Trading my sorrow, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness,
I'm trading my sickness,
I'm trading my pain,
trading my pain.
Oh, to lay them down,
I'm laying them down
for the joy of the Lord. Say it again, I'm trading my sorrow. Persecuted, not abandoned. So
run down but not destroyed. Yes, I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promises will endure, and his blessing's gonna be my strength.
Though the sorrow may last for the night, joy comes in the morning.
I gave him a sorrow,
I'm trading my shame.
Lord, I've laid them down.
I'm
trading my sickness.
And is to come.
You are alive. You're alive.
You're the Lamb. come, thy will be done. Your train fills the temple, for you are high and lifted up. Your name be praised.
Lift up the name of Jesus. We 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 lift up the name of Jesus. Your name be praised.
I am
which was and is and is to come.
You are alive.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Your train
fills
the temple,
for you are high and lifted up.
Your name be praised.
I am,
which was and is to come.
You are alive,
your land.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Your train fills the temple,
for you are high and lifted up.
Your name.
Jealous for me, love. love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so.
Sing it again. Oh,
oh, how he loves us so. Oh,
Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I found that name Jesus to be my strength. I found that name Jesus to be my strength. I wish you'd rise to your feet and just speak that name Jesus. People's lives are going to be changed in this service today. People are going to be healed today. I believe the power of God's going to move in somebody's life today. God's going to change something in somebody's family. I wish somebody just lift your hands up and say that name Jesus. Say that name Jesus. Say the name Jesus. Come on, church. His name. Say that name.
Oh, precious Jesus.
Yes, yes.
Oh, precious Jesus. What a wonderful name to me.
She's in the house this morning. The doctor said she would never live, but here she is. Sister Barbara used to be with her tambourine. Y'all remember Sister Barbara? She'd outdance the young folks. Oh, she's so beautiful, Sister Willie. Look at her. She's so good. Oh, come on. Love you, girl. Put your hands together once again for Sister Barbara. It's just to say that God is a miracle worker. We love her. We love her. We love her. Somebody say the name Jesus. Somebody say the name Jesus. Because I believe Jesus is in the house today. Jesus in the house again. Put your hands together for Sister Barbara one more time. Oh, somebody say Jesus. Say Jesus. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
A lot of people may be traveling today, but Jesus is in the house. Jesus is not on vacation today. Jesus in the house today. Somebody throw your hands up and say, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Do you love him? Do you love him? Do you love him? Do you love him? Just fall in love with Jesus for a couple moments. Just tell Jesus that you love him today. Oh, we love you, 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 we love you. Something about that name, Jesus. Jesus. Something Somebody begin to tell me, tell me, tell me, tell me. His
Jesus.
His name.
Jesus.
His name.
Jesus.
Jesus, the healer's in this building this morning. Jesus, the miracle worker's in this building this morning. Jesus is in this building this morning. Jesus is everything I have need of. Jesus is everything I have need of. Jesus is. Jesus is. Jesus is. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated if you're able. If not, go ahead and worship God. I just praise God for what God is doing. Just praise God that God is doing something great in the house. Now, put your hands together as Pastor Mike comes and his great family, get ready. You're going to be blessed.
Amen. Give Jesus a big hand.
While he is getting Anna's base ready, we just want to thank the Dobbs family. They have taken such good care of us since we've been here, and it's like a home away from home. My little girl was already crying last night because she has to leave Georgia. So you guys have an amazing pastor. You have amazing pastor's wife, very loving. His kids are awesome. Give them a big hand clap this morning. You guys are very, very lucky and blessed to have them a part of your lives. Amen. I'll just take a second here while he's still doing this. On the piano there, that is my son, Isaiah. He's 13. And back here on the drums, you can't see him very well, but that's my oldest. His name is Mikey, and he's 15. And this is our little princess, little Annabelle, and she's 11. And my name is Mandy, and you guys all know Pastor Mike. So we just want to thank you for the opportunity that we could come here and be blessed by you, but also be a blessing to you this morning. And while we get started, why don't you just go ahead and stand up, and we're going to usher in the presence of God, or continue to. Your worship team was amazing this morning. Give them a big hand clap. Your glory. this place this morning. He is a great big God. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, there's nothing worth more.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves when my heart becomes
around real quick. We were going to sing a different song, but how many would like to hear my little girl sing this morning? Amen. Is this one okay?
awestruck wonders at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, bread, the living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Praise the Lord. Come on, give them a big hand clap. How many? Amen. Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. This is Miracle Sunday, right? Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Give them all one more big hand clap. How many enjoy my family? Amen. Hallelujah. Any more? I just like to let them sing, and then I wouldn't have to preach at all. Let me say amen. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated just for a moment. Amen. I just real quick before, I know I'm supposed to turn this over to Pastor Steve, but before I do, I just want to ask, is there anybody that has fought anything this week to get here? Like three people? Anybody else? Anybody? Now listen, let me just think about this for a moment, because I don't know about you, but I think a lot of times the greatest miracle has to come through the greatest fight. The greatest victory comes through the greatest battle. Somebody in this place needs to get this with me today. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but somebody's been fighting something this week to be in service today. Somebody, listen, some people have been fighting dysfunction. Some people have been fighting battle. Some people have been fighting sickness. Some people have been fighting poverty. But thank God you're in church this morning. But come on, somebody, listen. Let me tell you right now, before we get started, how you can get the victory. I dare you to jump up to your feet and for 30 seconds praise God, not because the problem's gone, but because he sits high on the throne today. Hallelujah. Praise God. Listen, somebody said, well, Pastor Mike, if I just sit here and praise God, I'm ignoring my problem. I'm trying to say it's not there. Listen, I'm not telling you this morning to say that the problem's disappeared. I'm telling you to praise God in spite of the problem. Say, yeah, I still got a problem. Yeah, the devil's been fighting it, but I'm going to praise God in spite of it. Somebody ought to shout amen. Go ahead and give him about 30 seconds of praise. Come on, come on, somebody. If you got the Holy Ghost, I dare you to just go and start praying in the Holy Ghost and thank God that in spite of every situation, in spite of every problem, in spite of every setback, that you made it. I want somebody to yell real loud and tell the devil, I made it. You tried to stop me, but I made it. You tried to get me to give up, but I made it. Some of you almost gave up this morning when your alarm clock went off. In your heart, you thought, I don't feel like going to church today. I don't think I can make it, but you're here. You got up. You got dressed. You're in the house of God. Somebody say amen. I look at somebody and say, I didn't feel like coming this morning, but I made it. Come on, come on, tell them. Tell somebody else. I didn't feel like coming this morning, but I made it. I got to give Pastor Steve this microphone or I'll start preaching. Give your pastor, your great pastor, a big hand clap.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, this morning I want to receive an offering for Pastor Mike and his family, because at the close of the service he's going to be praying for folks. He's going to be ministering around these altars. He's going to be staying up here praying until God gives you a complete miracle. Hallelujah. I'm telling you now, y'all just need to get ready. Hallelujah. We're not going to spend a long time receiving the offering. All I want you to do is get a hold of that $20 bill, that $10 bill. I want you to get tied in with his anointing. Get tied in with his anointing. Hallelujah. You say, Pastor, you usually do at the end of the service. I just know what he's going to do at the end of the service. And sometimes that people walk out and don't bless the man of God. I want to bless him this morning. I want to bless the man of God this morning. So let's get a hold of that check for $20. Get a hold of that $10 bill. I'm not going to take much time. I just want you to get a hold of it. Don't even think about it. Just get a hold of it. Don't let the devil talk you out of your blessing. Get a hold of it. Get a hold of that seed right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless every seed. And God, we bless every seed in the name of Jesus for an increase in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I want everybody to get up and come and give something this morning. First Lady, you got my check? Oh, Lord, Pastor Eddie done beat me. Hallelujah. I want to be the first one to get it. Hallelujah. He beat me to it. Hallelujah. Everybody come and give something this morning. Don't miss tonight. I'm telling you, tonight with the cookout, tonight with the fellowship, tonight with all of the great things that are happening. Hallelujah. And while they're doing that, I'm going to ask for Sissy to tell you about the ladies' retreat, which is Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And Pastor Steve, I will be preaching Friday morning, even though the ladies at the ladies' retreat, I still will be preaching.
All right, ladies, this is our shirt for our retreat. Everybody give it up for our shirts that Pastor had made for us. I do have one spot available. There is rumor. I called this week to the facilities. They said there is rumor that I might be able to get one more cabin. So I do have definitely one spot, but if you're interested, see me. It's $100. That covers your food, your transportation, everything. And I'm telling you, you will come back changed. It's awesome.
Hello, you don't want to miss what God is doing. And starting next Sunday, I'll be starting the series, How to Reverse the Curse in Your Family. I'm tired of seeing the devil do the same thing to kids, do it to mama, do it to granny, do it to every single one of them. It's time that we stop that. It's time that we quit playing tag and passing this down from generation to generation. So it's so important for you to be here next week. It's Grandparents Day. We want to be honoring all the grandparents. I thought that was really funny because it kind of sounded like some of the grandparents. You know, my grandkids are here. Hallelujah, my grandkids are driving me crazy, especially if you get a whole bunch of them. Your sister Barbara, I think there's you back there. She's got like 20 grandkids, or I don't know how many it was. She got all kind of grandkids. Hallelujah. So make sure you're with us. And I'm going to turn this back over to Pastor Mike because he's ready to preach. And if you did not get a chance to come up here, I asked for Pastor Aubrey to set some baskets in the back in case that you didn't get a chance. You didn't want to walk up here. And after you get blessed, you want to bless the man of God. Hallelujah. Everybody stand back up to your feet. Put your hands together for this great man of God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. You all may be seated. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be able to come and minister this morning. Amen. On a holiday weekend. I like preaching on holiday weekends because the people that come want to be there. You could have went to the beach this morning if you wanted to, but you came to church. How many say amen? I said you could have went to the beach this morning if you wanted to, but you came to church. You figure I don't have to get up for work tomorrow, so I'm just going to go to the beach. I'm going to go camping. I'm going to go do something else. But you came to the house of God. How many say amen? And you know anybody that comes to Jesus expecting leaves receiving. How many is looking for a miracle today? I'm telling you, the miracle worker is in the house. I said the miracle worker is in the house. It's not me today. I know that the signs follow believers. I understand that. But the miracle worker is in the house. In our camp meeting this year, we probably saw in one night a dozen miracles. One man had a broken pelvis and a broken socket. Came in on crutches, and right during the service, nobody laid hands on him. We just saw a man come running up through holding crutches above his head, didn't it? Healed. We saw a young man had a big wound, was covered up with a bandage right during the service. Nobody prayed for him. We didn't call prayer service. He just took the bandage off, and the wound had healed up. It was about the size of a dime, and he was saying, go over here and ask my family. We saw one young man had a broken wrist. Nobody laid hands on him. The Holy Spirit was just moving in the service. People were expecting. People was expecting God to do something. Jumped up, said, I broke this wrist when I was a child. It never went back in place, and it just popped back in place. And he walked around, said it was out. Listen, that same thing could happen right here today. Wouldn't it be nice if you could leave this service this morning, call the people up that's been praying for you, and say, take me off the prayer list. I got my miracle this morning. God. Somebody say amen. I don't know what you've been praying for. You might have a group of people praying for you. Your pastor might be praying for you. Your first lady might be praying for you. You might have the elders of the church that have been praying about a situation. Wouldn't it be great tonight at the picnic? You could say, hey, by the way, that stuff you've been praying for, you don't have to pray about it anymore, because this morning I got my miracle. I left there receiving what God did in my life. How many say amen? I'm going to hurry up and get preaching. I don't even know if I got time to preach all this. If I don't have time to preach it tonight, I'll finish it. Or don't have time to preach it this morning, we'll finish it tonight. I'm going to say amen. Turn your Bibles to the book of Numbers chapter 14. While you're turning there, I want to thank your pastor and his family for the hospitality, and they have been such a blessing, and they have treated my family this week like their own family. And I just appreciate that so very much. That doesn't happen very often. Amen. And so if you find a few friends in a lifetime, you've really accomplished something. And so I love coming to Paxon because our friends are here. How many say amen? Amen. Numbers chapter 14, starting at verse 5. When you get there, say amen. Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel. But Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes, and they spake to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, "The land we pass through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. And if the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land, for they are bread. Their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them." And all the congregation said to stone them with stones, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the tabernacle of meeting before the children of Israel. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this great church. I thank you for this great group of people that you have assembled to be in this service to hear this word. Father, I believe that you have given me a on-time word today. I believe that this word is for this season. Father, I don't think it's for next year. I don't think it's for last year. I think it's for right now. Father, I pray that them that have an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Holy Spirit, anoint me this morning afresh and anew. Lord, I pray that you would take my broken words this morning and you would deposit them into the hearts of your people, that we might be changed, that we might leave here equipped and made alive by your word. And Father, I give you all the glory and the praise for it in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. This morning, I'm going to preach about having another spirit. But I believe that the church today, especially in America, and I'm sure around the world, it's hard for me to speak about the church around the world because I rarely go around the world, but I can speak about the Church of America, and I believe that the Church in America needs a reformation. You say, what is a reformation? It is a reforming. It is a shifting. It is a paradigm shift. It is a changing of principles, a shifting. I believe today that what takes place is that what was taboo in our grandparents' generation has become accepted in our parents' generation, and today it is being promoted in our generation. With every new generation, as the paradigm shifts, as the standard is watered down, as it is seems as though it has gone more worldly, that in every generation we have drifted farther and farther away from the truth. Now, I don't know how many of you are with me, but does anybody remember cassettes? Some of y'all remember 8-tracks. Some of y'all can go back farther than that, and you used to have them big black disc-looking things. That's before me. I came around right at the end of 8-tracks and right at the beginning of cassettes. But listen, let me tell you something. It's a little different now with digital audio, but with cassettes, when you were trying to record something, you would get a master copy. And then you would duplicate from that master copy, because if you made a copy from a copy, I mean, know what I'm talking about. you would lose generations. It was that we called it losing generations. We used to travel around and do tent revivals and all these types of things, and I was always making copies, but you could never make a copy from a copy because you would lose a generation. You would lose quality. And then if you made a copy from that copy, you would lose another generation. And sometimes you would get cassettes, and that's why they would have terrible quality, because with every copy they made, every time you went farther from the standard, you went farther from the master, you got a watered down, weak, anemic copy of the original. Are you here today? And I believe that that's what's taking place in America, that with every generation, because we have watered down the gospel, because we have failed to hold up the standard, because we have come on, I wish I had half a church in here this morning. I don't know about you, I come to preach this morning. Somebody needs to get this in your spirit. We need to see a reformation. We need to have a shift back to that which was holy. We need to have a shift back to godliness. We need to have a shift back to the power of the Holy Ghost that moves and operates and demonstrates, because we see a generation today that because we watered down the standard, they have no standard. Because we loosened up the standard, there is no standard. Everything goes. Do what thou will. Whatever feels good, do it. I don't know about you, but I still believe there's a standard that we ought to live by. And I believe if we're ever going to get into the promises of God, we're ever going to step into the promised land, we have got to have a reformation, a shifting back to the standard. Somebody say with me. We got the children of Israel here today. They were at the brink of the promised land. They had already, through the strength and the power of God, saw the greatest dynasty on the face of the earth, the Egyptians. That had been the greatest dynasty for hundreds of years. They had saw this great dynasty on the earth fall to its knees. They had saw the great armies of Pharaoh be buried under the Red Sea. They saw the plagues that had fell upon Egypt. They saw the frogs and the lice and the fire that fell down from heaven. And they saw the firstborn of every person that wasn't covered in the blood. That's a good message right there. They saw the first blood of everyone. The first that weren't covered under the blood, they died, the firstborn. Are you with me today? They had been in the Egyptian culture, the Bible says, for 430 years. But then God spoke to Moses and said, I've heard the cries of my people from their taskmasters, and I want you to go down and I want you to deliver them. Are you in this house with me today? Stick with me. I promise, stick with me. We're going somewhere. He said, I want you to deliver them from their taskmaster. And he went down with one message on his heart. Let God's people go. Let my people go. Is anybody in this place with me today? He said, let them go. Listen, I believe that God designed for his people to be free. For whom the Son sets free is free indeed. If you're bound in here today, you're not living up to God's potential in your life. He wants you to be free. Free from alcohol. Free from pornography. Free from all types of things. Depression. Discouragement. He wants us to be free. Now for 430 years, let me get through my text and I promise I'll preach. For 430 years, they knew, all they knew about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was that he was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Think about this for a moment. For 430 years, they lived with the Egyptians. They dressed like the Egyptians. They talked like the Egyptians. They cut their hair like the Egyptians. They spoke the language. They went to school. You figure this nation has only been birthed for, say, what, 239, 240 years, the United States of America. How much has the culture changed today from 1776? And you can imagine in 239 years how much our culture has changed. How much did the culture change with Israel when they were 430 years? The only thing they knew about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was the stories. But the culture was Egyptian. They were only Israelite by birth. They were only Israelite by genealogy, but everything else about them was Egyptian. Oh, I wish I had somebody here with me today. They dressed like the Egyptians. They talked like the Egyptians. They went to the places where the Egyptians went. They hung out with the Egyptians. They partied with the Egyptians. Their culture was Egyptian. And now God was calling this group of people out of the culture. He was taking a group of people that had a spiritual genealogy and a heritage, and he was pulling them out of the culture. And I believe today that that's what God wants to do with this generation. He wants to take a generation that doesn't know anything about. Come on, somebody. We start talking about spiritual heritage, and we start talking about the John G. Lakes and Smith Wigglesworth and A.A. Allens. They're just stories that we've heard. But God's raising up a generation that has a spiritual genealogy, and he's pulling them out in the wilderness so he can change the culture, so he can see a reformation and take them into the promised land. Listen, I'm going on. See, there was a spirit that had controlled the Egyptian culture. The Egyptian culture, they were polytheistic. They worshiped all types of gods, many gods. They worshiped all types of things. They worshiped Ra, the sun god. They had all these other different gods that they served. They even worshiped the Nile River. I'm sure that the Israelites over the past 430 years had even grown into the Egyptian religion. And yeah, they still serve God. And yeah, they still would, you know, do little things here and there to try to bring it back to how it used to be. But as a mainstream, they were caught up in everything that their culture was caught up in. Y'all didn't come to hear this? Y'all wish you would have went camping instead? Listen. 430 years they were in the culture. They were controlled by the spirit that was motivating them. Listen, I don't know if you believe it or not, but I believe that there are principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and spiritual wickedness that sets up camp in countries and in cities. Come on, somebody. Have you ever just went to some cities and see a particular sin that's more prevalent than in other cities? You go to some cities and you just see poverty has taken over. You go to some cities and it looks like homosexuality has taken over. You go to some cities and you see that drug addiction has just taken over. You go to some cities and it seems like depression has just taken over. Are you here today? Listen, I'll let you know, there is a devil loose today. There is a, come on, we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but we're wrestling against principalities and rulers and powers and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. My God, I believe we could get so much more accomplished if we quit fighting in the flesh and start fighting in the spirit, and we'd put on the whole armor of God wherewith we might be able to stand against the wiles or schemes of the enemy. They were controlled by the spirit that was promoting and pushing and empowering this Egyptian culture. Now listen, think about this for a moment. I'm going somewhere. How many believe in the Holy Spirit? How many believe that the Holy Spirit is loosed on the earth? Do you know what the goal and the purpose of the Holy Spirit is? It is to prepare the bride of Christ for its Christ. Right? It is to equip, to empower. Bible says when you receive this gift of the Holy Ghost, you shall be endued with power. Come on, somebody. Power to what? Power to live right. Power to talk right. Power to be witnesses wherever you might be. Come on. Then he goes ahead and gives us the gifts of the Spirit and says you can lay your hands on the sick and they shall recover. And you can prophesy. And you can see divers tongues and interpretation and miracles and revelation knowledge and wisdom. We understand that. We understand that the Holy Spirit has been released on the earth to prepare the bride for the second coming of Christ. Right? How many believe that Jesus is still coming back? Huh? I know we could get in a great theological discussion on when he's coming back. To me, I just say be ready at all time. I'm going to be ready if he comes back before this service is over. If I get caught up in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, I want to be ready. Hello? The Holy Spirit is preparing the body of Christ for the return of Jesus Christ. That's his job. That's what he's been sent here to do. Now let me tell you something else. There's also another spirit that has been released on the earth. Oh, think about this. John chapter 1 verses 4 and 3. It says, "And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world." So we see that the Holy Spirit today is preparing the church for the coming of Christ. But there is another spirit that's loosed in the earth that is preparing the world for the Antichrist. Come on, somebody. Listen, just as real as there's a Holy Spirit and there's a Jesus Christ that somehow and someday is going to step over the sapphire seal of heaven's gates and call us home, there is also an Antichrist spirit that is real. John said it was already at work in his day, and he's preparing the world for this one world leader that's about to show up and give every man a mark. Is there anybody going to preach with me today? The Bible talks about it, that without this mark you'll neither buy, sell, or trade. It's a, come on somebody, an Antichrist. There is an Antichrist that's coming. He's going to set up a 7-year treaty with Israel. 3.5 years into the treaty, he's going to, come on. The way I read the Bible, I should be watching all this from heaven at the marriage supper of the Lamb, catching up updates on Facebook. But there's an Antichrist spirit that is preparing the world. Don't think all the things that are going on in the world are just by chance. Don't think that there's not a spirit that is promoting. Because you know what? The Antichrist couldn't come. Don't even think that a lot of the technologies that we're seeing today and the information gathering, don't think that the computer technology, don't think that the illegal immigration and a lot of these problems, don't think that ISIS, you know what? The Bible says when it talks about the Antichrist that he is against everything that is God. Do you know that Christianity is the most persecuted religion in the world today? You know why? Because there is a spirit of Antichrist that has rose up in the world that is against everything that calls itself holy and everything that is of God. Why do you think that now all of a sudden Christians are being beheaded around the world? Not because they did a crime, not because of anything other than they claim the name of Jesus Christ and they refuse to deny their faith. Somebody, do you know that just a few hours away from where we are right now, that there's a woman in Kentucky that is sitting in jail? Sitting in jail because she refuses to deny her faith. Not in Russia, not in China, in the United States of America. Don't tell me there's not an Antichrist spirit that's being released in America and around the world. What's he doing? He's preparing the world for this one world leader that's about to rise up. Don't think that he's going to operate in the world without creeping over to the church. Hello? We see huge churches being built in America. This might not be shout message, but God, he'll still do miracles. That we're building huge churches around America where there's never altar calls. Where I live in West Virginia, some of the biggest churches in our area, I've talked to people that went to those churches. They've been going there 6, 7, 8 years. There's never been an altar call. There's never been an opportunity to accept. What else could you preach about? Never have an opportunity and say you need to get saved and you need to accept Jesus Christ in your life. Come on, somebody. No, we preach that they stand behind pulpits and preach about how to get rid of your problem and how to deal with this and how to deal with that. What you need to deal with is the sin that's causing it. Maybe if we would get rid of the sin, we wouldn't have to deal with a lot of the problems we deal with. It creeps over into the church. It creeps into over in every area of ministry. Huh? We don't. Many of them don't preach about the blood. They don't preach about the risen Savior. Most of them have given up the fact that Jesus is coming back after a church. They don't preach about a rapture. They don't preach about a catching away. They don't preach about a resurrection. They don't preach about healing. You say, what is it? That's not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is preparing the church for the bride. If you got the Holy Spirit in operation, He's going to be preparing us for the bride. He's going to be preparing the bride for the bridegroom. We're going to be getting ready, prepared. We're going to be getting our hearts washed and clean and our wedding garments on, and we're going to get impressed without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. Waiting for the bridegroom to call at the midnight hour. The Holy Spirit was operating. He'd be telling them, keep your oil filled. Keep your lights trimmed. Because in an hour when you think not, He's going to show up like a thief in the night. Come on, somebody. He might show up halfway through your late night double feature. He might show up halfway through you meeting somebody that's not your wife in a hotel room. I don't know. I just got to preach this. He might show up halfway. Come on. That's why you got to be ready. We ain't got time for sin. He could come at any moment. He could come at any moment. There's a spirit that's been released. Listen, I don't have time to preach it. Maybe I can finish up tonight. I don't know. There's a spirit that's been released in America, been released around the world. It's preparing. A lot of these things that we see taking place in the world is simply under the push and promotion of the spirit of Antichrist that is getting things prepared for the Antichrist. The same way the Holy Spirit is preparing us for the coming of our Christ. Amen? Do you believe that with me today? Do you believe that? We see it in our government. Listen, I don't know if you caught it or not. A lot of people may not be real up on. Whenever they were just doing some of these debates, I was kind of paying attention. They were going down through each one that gave debates. Check it out. Google it, whatever. They were asking about how to solve the immigration problem. Every one of them said, we got to come up with some kind of a chip. Every one of them. We got to come up with some kind of e-chip. Wonder where they ever heard of something like that at. What is it going on? The spirit of the Antichrist is using a lot of these things that are going on. 9/11, we never collected data like we do today. There are buildings in the United States of America that are larger than our largest factories that have nothing in them but servers that are collecting data. They're collecting data on our telephone calls and our visiting our websites. That stuff never took place before, but because of terrorism, the Antichrist spirit has shifted some things around because he's got to get ready for somebody that can come in and set up a one world government. Somebody that can put a mark on every person. What a great idea. What a great idea to get this computer chip placed in your hand. I don't know what it's going to be, the mark of the or the mark of the beast. I'm sure technology will even evolve more. But wouldn't it be a great idea to put a mark on everybody? Then you wouldn't be able to sell drugs to your kids anymore because they'd have to use transactions. And we'd know who's in the country and who's not. And we wouldn't have to wait in lines at airplanes. What a great idea. Nobody be able to steal anything from you anymore because there ain't no money. You just go through the cash register. They're already geared up for it. You don't have a mark in your hand now, but you can do it with your credit card. You just walk by, beep, put your stuff in, How many say amen? What about federal ID cards that are supposed to come in the United States of America? They're already in your driver's license, these little chips. All they got to do is wait for 2017 to turn them all on. That's why they tell you right now when you go to the DMV that you can have it if you want to, but in 2017 it's mandatory. It's just all setting up. I don't have time to preach end times, but listen, I do want to let you know there is a spirit of Antichrist that is working in the government, it's working in our people, it's working in society, and it is setting the world up for the coming of, come on, is there anybody here? For their Christ, their son of perdition, the one that they said was going to be the abomination of desolation. They're setting up for him. Hello? Listen, it's invaded our churches. It's invaded our churches where we try to entertain people rather than preach them the gospel. We try to see how many we can pack in buildings. Listen, what time is it? Time to preach? If I was going to build the largest school in America, you know what I would do? I would go find all the dropouts. I would go find all the people that didn't want to go to school. I would find all the ones that were skipping. I'd find all the ones that didn't like school, and I'd ask them what kind of school they wanted. And then they'd probably tell me they'd like to have a school where there wasn't any teachers. They'd like to have a school where there wasn't any grades. They'd like to have a school where we ate pizza every day for lunch. And that sounds good. Thank you. We'd like to have a school where we don't have to come if we don't feel like it. We'd like to have a school that if we felt like showing up, we would. We'd like to have a school with a smoking section in it. And you know what? I could build a school to their standards and probably have one of the biggest schools in the area. Every dropout, every skipper, every person that didn't want to go to school, they would love to come to my school. But how well would I be preparing them? How well would I be preparing them for the next phase in their lives? But that's how we build churches. Come on, somebody. Just preach us a 45-minute message and don't touch on sin. Don't preach about repentance. Don't put any demand on us. Don't take an offering, and we'll have the biggest church in the area. But I'll let you know, you won't make it through the trials and tests that's coming through your life. If you want to make it, you got to find someplace where they like this church, where the word's preached, where the anointing falls, where the Holy Ghost is moving in an operation. Getting back to Joshua and Caleb. I didn't leave them. This great crowd, or we brought our text, this great crowd assembled because they didn't like the way Moses was doing stuff. They came back and saw these giants. They said, you should have left us in Egypt. Wasn't there enough graves in Egypt that you brought us out here to die in this mess? Here was a whole crowd of people, but two of them jumped up and said, hey, don't act like this. Don't rebel against God. Said, I saw the same giants these other eight jokers saw. And we're more than enough. Said, their defenses have departed. They're like bread. They said, don't rebel against God. Listen, I wanted to say that to say this. Yes, the Antichrist spirit is released and moving on the earth today, I believe, more stronger than in any other generation. But I also want to tell you, not everybody's in the crowd with them. Not everybody is under the influence of the spirit that's preparing for this Antichrist to show up. There's still some people that have another spirit. There's still some people that still have the power of God in operation. There's still some people that believe that God can do exceedingly and abundantly above anything we can ask or think. Huh? Hallelujah. God always has some people in the crowd that aren't like everybody else. Is there anybody in here that you just not like everybody else? I don't know about you. I don't fit in with the world. And I don't fit in with most of the church either. Huh? I got another spirit. Ain't nobody going to shout with me now. I don't know about you. That's when you can find out you're where God wants you to be, because you don't fit in with the world and you don't fit in with most of the backslidden church. And you just feel a lot of people are discouraged and depressed and lonely, and they're running around saying, I just don't fit in anywhere and nobody likes me and I don't have any friends. Well, you're exactly where God wants you to be. He didn't call you to get in with that mess. He didn't call. That's how you know you've been called to possess the promises of God. Somebody say amen. Look here what it says in Numbers chapter 14, verses 29 through 31. It says, and the carcasses of those that have complained against me shall fall in the wilderness, all of you who were numbered according to the entire number from 20 years old and above, except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun. You shall by no means, enter into the land which I swore to make you to dwell in, but your little ones whom you said would be victims, I'll bring them in, and they shall know the land which you have despised. Look at verses 23 and 24. It says, they surely shall not see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who reject me see it, but my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit in him. Now see, that's the people I came to preach to this morning. I'm off loosening my tie up a little bit. I feel like I'm preaching a little bit in here this morning. Is that okay if I just loosen my tie up a little bit? See, listen, I didn't come to preach to those that have the same old spirit that everybody else did. If you come in here and you got that same old spirit that the other 8 spies have, you know how you can tell them? Because they got that murmur and that grumbling and that complaining. Come on, somebody. You can always tell those that have that same old spirit because the music's either too loud or it's not loud enough, or the preacher was too long, or he wasn't long enough, or the service was too long, or it wasn't long enough. Somebody say amen. I come to preach this morning to those that have another spirit. Listen, if you got that same old spirit, just scribble in a tithing envelope for a few moments while the rest of us get something here this morning, because I come to preach to somebody that has another spirit, that you say, I'm different. I dare to deviate. I done stepped out of that mold. Come on, somebody. I don't worship like everybody else worships. And I don't praise God like everybody else does. And I don't go to church like everybody else does. I got a different spirit. I don't know who I'm here preaching to. Anybody here got a different spirit? You got another spirit. Sometimes it discourages you because you feel like you're different than everybody else. Am I preaching to the right church folk in here? You say, I'm just different than everybody else. I don't know what it is. I see things different than other people do. I perceive things differently than other people do. Everybody else is saying we can't do it, and there's something in me says we still can. Everybody else is saying there's giants in the land. Everybody else is saying, we're not strong enough. We're not big enough. We can't do it. But something down inside of me, I'm with them, but I'm not of them. I might be sitting in the same pew with them, but I don't act like them. I might have went to that same school, but I graduated. Come on, somebody. You might even have to do that with your family sometime. You're sitting with your family, and they're all sitting there, and you're trying to look like you're with them, but down in your heart, you say, I got another spirit. They think we're going under. I think we're going over. They think we're going to be sick. I think we're going to walk into divine health. They went to the beach this morning. I got up, went to church. A different spirit. You know how you can tell who's going to possess the promises of God? Those that have a different spirit. Now listen, I just read that text. I'm hurrying up. I'm going to try to get you out of here by 3:00 on the dot. If you're here any longer than 3 o'clock, we're blaming my wife for singing an extra song. She won't take it. She always takes the blame for me. Said that these two had a different spirit. Look here, I read to you, it said that God spoke to them after their rebellion and said, everyone from the age, under the age of 20 years old, from 19 years old down, they are going to see, or from 20 years old down, they will see the promises of God. All the rest of you, you're going to see their carcasses in the desert. Now think about this for a moment. You say, well, God must be about age. It's not, has anything to do with age. Because then right after he told him that, he said, except for Caleb. Caleb wasn't under 20 years old. Caleb was 40 years old. We read in the book of Joshua, he said, I was 40 years old when we went into the promised land. They rebelled against God. He said, now I'm 85 years old. And he said, I'm just as able now as I was then. It didn't have anything to do with the age. Because Joshua and Caleb, if it was an age thing, Joshua and Caleb couldn't have got in. Because it would have been about age. But he said, it's not about age. He said, here's what it's about. It's about that 430-year-old culture. He said, for those that are over 20 years old, they remember what it was like to be back in Egypt. They still dress like the Egyptians. They still talk like the Egyptians. But he said, these young babies, they didn't know what it was like to be in Egypt. They grew up in the wilderness. They never went to the Egyptian schools. They never talked like the Egyptians. They didn't walk like the Egyptians. They weren't educated like the Egyptians. They had another spirit. See, the whole thing that God was doing was he was doing a reformation. He was trying to get rid of the culture. He was trying to get rid of that spirit that had invaded that generation for 430 years. He said, all these from 20 years older, they're controlled by one spirit. But this other group, they're controlled by another spirit. Then he started to look around at all the older ones that was there. He said, but you know what? The more I look around, I see two more that have another spirit. They might have been in Egypt, but they wasn't of Egypt. They might have lived in Egypt, but they didn't act like it. Hey, they might have grew up and went to school there, but they did. They got another spirit. He said, and you know what? I'm going to use these two and this other group that have not been indicted with the culture that have another spirit. And those are the ones I'm going to give the promise. Listen, that's what God wants to do in your life. That's what God wants to do in this church. That's what God wants to do in this nation. He's raising up another generation, not by age, but ones that have a different spirit. Now, you can shout because you got a different spirit. Because you're the one that God's going to use to possess the promises. Here's what I got to ask you. Can you stand to be a 2 out of 10? Can you stand to be in the minority? Can you stand to be persecuted for your faith? Can you stand to walk in a revolution? Oh, I wish I had somebody here. Because listen, I just want to let you know, 8 out of 10 aren't going to agree with you. 8 out of 10 aren't going to pat you on the back and say, good job. 8 out of 10, they're going to talk about stoning you and throwing you in jail. Come on, because there's a spirit that's been released that is against us. There's a there's a spirit that's been released in the world that is against Christians and against those that call the name of Jesus. And there's only going to be about 2 out of 10 that's going to be able to stand up. But God's going to take that 2 out of 10 and they're going to possess the promises of God in this last day move of the Holy Spirit. He's looking for people that have a different spirit, have another spirit. If you got the same old spirit, I'd hurry up and fake like you don't before anybody finds out. I'd start moving to the front. They'll think you're close with the pastor. Come on. He's looking for those that have a different spirit. Those that still believe in prayer. Those still that believe in sanctity. Those still that believe in sanctification and holiness. Come on. It doesn't matter your age. It matters your spirit. Listen, I can just tell you something. We're going to preach tonight. I'm going to really get fired up tonight. Listen, at our church, I just told you about our camp meeting. Pastor Steve was at our camp meeting. In one particular night, we had Eddie James in the service. The place was packed. We saw probably 25 people come up and get saved. Probably 25, 30 people baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Probably a dozen people received miracles. I mean, just miracles. And I told you about a few of them before the service. They just received miracles. And you know what? In that service, you would not believe the persecution that we received from that service. Because Eddie James had their dance team on the stage. It wasn't from our church. We done ran all them off. But people saying God's not in that because they were dancing. God's not in that because they weren't wearing a suit and tie. God's not in. I said, how can you say that God is not in 30 people getting saved, 25 people getting baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, people bringing their crutches up, people taking, one man had these braces on his arms. Am I telling the truth? He just walked up, took the braces off of his arms, and started walking around in the service. And there were people, you know why? Because they didn't have a different spirit. They still had that same old spirit. Come on, somebody. They still had that same old spirit where they was putting God in a box. And they were so concerned with young people that were on crack and heroin and drug addiction and all types of things dancing on the stage that they couldn't see the move of God. Listen, they're going to die. Their carcasses will be in the desert. But God is raising up another generation that has a different spirit. And these are the ones that are going to step in. And they're going to take back everything the enemy stole from them. These are the people that will live in houses that they didn't build. And drink from wells that they didn't dig. And eat from vineyards that they didn't plant. Because they got a different spirit. Been such in my spirit. We got to come up with a different spirit. We got to have another spirit. That same old spirit that we've been using to grumble and complain, walking around in unforgiveness and walking around with hatred and walking around with jealousy and bitterness, and we're sitting around trying to find, I'm sure it don't go on down here, that's a West Virginia thing, but they sit in service and try to find fault and try to find reasons why God's not in it. That's a wrong spirit. That spirit can't live. That spirit won't possess the promises of God. Somebody shout, I got another spirit. I got another spirit. Come on. I got another spirit. Look at somebody besides you. Excuse me, but I got another spirit. That's why I act different than you do. Look over at somebody and say, excuse me in advance. I might shout a little bit here in a minute because I got another spirit. I just want to go ahead and let you know right now, if I look like I'm a little different than you, it's because I am. I got another spirit. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place right now. Huh? Oh, say, I got a different spirit. I react differently. I believe we can still do it. Let's see where I'm at in my notes. I don't know. I lost them. Maybe we'll find them tonight. God is raising up people in this day that have a different spirit. And those are the people that are going to possess the promises of God. I'm telling you, those are the people. They're not been inundated by the culture. That thing jumped off of me at the page whenever I read that they were in bondage for 430 years. I thought, if 430 years, they wasn't anything like Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob. They didn't dress like them. They didn't know them. It was like us thinking about George Washington or Abraham Lincoln. We never met them. We didn't know them. We just read about them in history books. That's what they were thinking about, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They never even started doing a lot of the Jewish feasts and stuff until after they got out of that mess. And today, the culture, the spirit of Antichrist. You know why our nation is making laws that go against the Word of God? Because the spirit of Antichrist is loose. Don't be surprised. Don't be taken back. The spirit of the Antichrist is flowing, moving, operating, preparing. It's creeping into the church. But there's some of us that still have another spirit. There's some of us that still have another spirit. Listen, if you got another spirit in here, jump up to your feet. Lord, I thank you right now that I have another spirit. I'm not going to allow the culture. I am not going to allow the culture to dictate me. I know I live in this world, but I'm not going to be of this world. I'm not going to dress like they dress. I'm not going to talk like they talk. I'm not going to react like they react. I'm not going to listen to what they listen to. I'm not going to watch what they watch. I got a different spirit. I got a different spirit. I got a different spirit. And I'm going to possess the promises of God. Woo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tell you what, I'm waiting on God to take a look around. And I'm waiting for him to say, none of this world is going to be able to possess the promises except you and you and you and you and you. Because they got a different spirit. And you, oh, come on, somebody. And you, and you, and you. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. I'm waiting for God. He said, there's a broad road that leads to destruction. Many there will be that find it. But there's a road that's straight and narrow. Few there be that find it. That's going to be the ones that have a different spirit. Hallelujah. If you got another spirit, I want you to lift your hands up right now and start worshiping them. My God. Come on, feel the Holy Ghost in here. Is there anybody in here this morning? Is this okay? Is there anybody here this morning, you've been suffering in your feet? If you've been suffering in your feet, run up here. There might be a bunch of you. I don't know. But I just feel like if you've been suffering in your feet, you've been suffering in your feet. Y'all been suffering in your feet?
Come on, church. I feel the anointing of God. Come on, I need somebody to help me pray. I believe this is the beginning of what God's going to do tonight. Don't get in a hurry this morning. God is working at work. God is working at work. God is working at work.
Authority in the name of Jesus. And Father, right now they come in alignment. I command them right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. All right, let's move them. Let's walk around. What would they hurt? How's your knees?
Is
there any pain in them?
I want
listen, this is to build your faith. She said she come up, she had heel spurs, and she fell and hurt her knees. Do you feel any pain?
No.
All the pain's gone? Church, rejoice.
I want more.
Hallelujah.
I want more. I want more. I want more. I want more of you, God. I want more. 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 I want more of you, God. I want more. I want more. I want more. I want more. I want more of you, God. I want more. 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 I want more.
Somebody rejoice! Come on, somebody shout. Hallelujah.
I want more.
Hallelujah. How many's up here for feet? If you're up here for feet, come up here just real quick. Just make a line. I'm just going to go through and touch you real quick. Hallelujah. So everybody's here for feet? Okay, make a straight line. Make me a straight line. I just want to go down through and just lay hands on everybody. Okay? Lord, in the name of it, everybody stretch your hands here this way real quick. Y'all all for feet? All right, get in line. I'm just going to go down through. I want to lay hands. We're going to be praying for people tonight, too, in service. If you didn't get prayer this morning, come tonight. We're going to be laying hands on the sick, believing God from the recover. Amen? All for feet. Everybody put your hands up right now to receive it. Lord, in the name of Jesus, as I lay hands on them, I speak to every malfunction, every abnormality, every tendon, arthritis, whatever it is that's causing pain in their feet to go. And Lord, as we lay hands on them, as a contact of faith, Father, that healing's going to come in Jesus' name right now. How to, Lord, right now. Right now. 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 Move your feet. Move your feet. Move your feet. Move your feet. The pain's gone. Move your feet. The pain's gone. Move your feet. Shit, yeah. Move your feet. Let up a shikata. Move your feet. See, let up a koshata. Oh, yeah. 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 Just move your feet. Move your feet. Walk in faith. Let up a shikita. Let up a koshata. Walk in faith. Move them. Move those feet. Say, Lord, that I'm walking in my healing. I'm walking in my healing. Hallelujah. Receive it, receive it, receive it, receive it, receive it, receive it, receive it. Your mother's foot. Lord, right now, as she stands in the gap for her mother, we send your word. Woo! Send your word. Lord, right now, this moment. Hallelujah. Lord, right now, I decree healing in these feet now. In the name of Jesus, I decree healing. Touch her right now. Let the glory of God fall. Hallelujah. Whew, yeah, it's already yours. You already got it. Just walk in it. Walk your feet. Walk in it. Walk in it. Walk in it. Walk in it. You already got it. You already got healing. Right now, divine healing. Woo! Yeah, yeah. That don't look like sore feet to me. Go ahead. Go ahead. Right now, we decree it. We declare it. In the name of Jesus. Oh, come. My God, my God, my God, my God. Hallelujah. Lord, right now, we decree it. Healing. Healing in these feet. I speak healing to them now in the delegated authority in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Just go ahead and move in. Walk in it. Walk in it. Walk in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.